Hi everyone, this is Sagar Shah and today I have with me a very special guest, GM Swapnil Dhopade. Swapnil, welcome to Chessbase India.
Thank you, Sagar.
Well, Swapnil is my very old friend. He is also one of India's top players, 40th grandmaster. And what are you doing in Mumbai?
I've come here to train one of my students. And it's all, I think, the fourth day today. So tomorrow is the final day.
Okay.
And basically I've come here to train him.
Wonderful. So you are here as a trainer. We have a lot to talk with you about your training, what's going on in your life.
Yeah.
But the main intention of this entire session is Ask Swapnil. Okay, this is the name of the show. We wanted people to interact with you, to ask questions which are there in their mind. You know, there is someone who says, I'm stuck in this rating for years together. I don't know how to improve. There are people who say, we don't know what are the best books in chess.
Yeah.
So all of these people do not have a way to communicate with a player of your stature.
Right.
So thank you for doing this.
Even I would like to help a lot of people, the viewers of Chessbase India.
Yeah.
And even I get a lot of questions when they meet me personally and all. But communicating through a channel like Chessbase India is really great because we can reach a lot of people.
Sure.
And help them.
Sure. And we already have a lot of people online. So I'm just giving a shout out to everyone. Angel, Coronel, Srinivas, Venkat Ramani, Jadav Police, Pradeep Kanetkar, Vishal Kamath, Ravi Singh, Parmar Bhagya, Bindu Ila, Shushma Dwivedi, SSR King, Omkar Brahmabhat, Poonam Jadav, lot of people are already here. So guys, I hope that you can listen to us well. In case if you have any issues about sound or quality, just let us know. Okay, we should maybe talk a little bit louder.
Yeah.
But whatever questions you have, please let us know in the comments section. And we would like to take it on. But before we begin with the question and answer, let's have a look at one of your game, a very short fraction or fragment of the game.
Yeah, I've selected my game against Nilotpal. It was played in National A in Thiruvarur. And the tournament wasn't going well for me. But after this game, okay, I felt a bit good because it was a nice positional win.
Okay.
So we'll start with it.
So we can have a look at this just to make sure that sound is okay. I'll just this here. Let's see, and maybe I'm always loud, so I'll give you both the mics. Okay.
Okay.
I hope that you will be able to listen to Swapnil better. Here's the game. Swapnil, you are white.
Yeah, I was white.
And black was
Nilotpal Das,
Nilotpal
a very strong
Das.
Grandmaster from Kolkata, from West Bengal. Yeah, knight c3. And Nilotpal plays a lot of openings, so I was not sure what he will choose for the game. But I played what I usually play against QGD.
Which is bishop f4.
Bishop f4 line, yes.
Okay.
So bishop f4 castles, e3, knight bd7. Now, I just took c into d5, knight into d5, knight into d5, e into d5. I just developed the bishop to the most logical diagonal, bishop d3, and now here he played c5, which is again very normal castle, and here he surprised me with c captures d4, because usually they try to expand on the queen side with c4 and maybe b5, a5, and they try to gain space on the queen side. But c into d4 was a surprising decision,
and here I had a choice whether should I go for knight into d4
or e into d4. Again, if I play knight into d4, I'll play against the IQP, and already, as you can see, one pair of pieces is already exchanged.
Okay.
So it's maybe a comfortable version for me of IQP, but if I take e into d4, it has its own advantages. So
so maybe we can ask the viewers.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe viewers can guess what they can choose as white here.
Yeah, maybe the viewers can decide what move should be played here by white.
Yeah.
What did Swapnil do? Meanwhile, I think some of the people have said that we have to speak a little louder.
Okay.
So let's do that.
Yeah.
Okay. So until you guys figure out what is to be done here, I'll just make sure that everyone can listen to the sound well. Yeah, maybe now is the sound okay? If anyone can confirm if the sound is fine. Okay, so we have a few answers here.
Yeah.
Girish Shah says knight into d4, Poonam Jadhav knight d4, Sagar Chess knight takes d4, Gargi d4, knight d4, Janil Patel knight d4. I think very few people. Siva GM says ed4, Srinivas and Akira Vanche says ed4, Anjali Savalkar. Okay. So these are the people, but I would say 80% of the people think knight into d4.
Yeah, even during the game I felt that knight d4 is very logical. But I captured the pawn with my e pawn, that is a into d4. Basically, there is nothing much to calculate in such decisions. We just have to take it on logic and our past experience.
Well, so, if I was white, I would have definitely wanted to take with the knight.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
This is a beautiful square for the knight. This pawn is slightly weak.
True. Yeah, I think yeah, it's very logical, but the benefit of taking e into d4 is that since white black has already developed the knight to d7, the knight is not coming to c6. Yeah, so when the knight is on c6, maybe e into d4 is not such a great idea because our d pawn will always be under pressure. But with the knight on d7, it is not so well placed there, and black has to waste a few more moves to develop the to move the knight and develop the bishop from c8. So in the meantime, maybe I can do something and try to seize the initiative or create some weaknesses in black's camp.
Fantastic. What a concept. So the basic point which Swapnil is trying to say, and maybe I'll just try to look at it in a different way. Say, if he played c5,
yeah.
Cd, knight d5, knight d5, ed5, bishop, say e2,
yeah.
And
knight
here if he takes.
Yeah. Maybe here I will of course take with the knight.
Here you would take with the knight because let's say if you took with the pawn.
Then knight c6 and my according to my experience, usually in these positions, the knight attacking the pawn, let's here in this case it's the c6 knight which is attacking the d4 pawn. In such situations, the knight which is attacking the pawn is comparatively better than the knight which is defending the pawn. So the knight on c6 is much better than the knight on f3.
Fantastic, fantastic. We had one comment in the viewers who said, when I said we take, I would have taken knight d4, they said, that's why you are a GM and I am not. Well, makes sense completely. But I think it's a very good understanding, deep positional understanding, that in a symmetrical position as well, white can fight for an advantage.
Yeah, true. It depends a lot on the placement of your pieces, the activity of your pieces, and whether the opponent has completed his development or not. In this case, obviously, black still needs to develop his queen set.
Yes. Okay, so knight f6 was played, queen b3.
Yeah, so again, I'm trying to stop the development of his c8 bishop.
Mm.
So I'm not letting him develop very easily.
So this is hanging here.
Yeah.
So he must go, he went bd6.
Bd6, yeah.
You went bishop g5, putting pressure on d5.
D5 pawn, yes.
Queen b6, you took.
Yeah.
Took. And we come to this position, which I don't understand. I mean, queens are exchanged. Black has the bishop pair.
Yeah.
These pawns look a little weak. These pawns, what's going on?
Basically, yeah, it is true that black has the bishop pair. But in this position, in this endgame, the bishop pair is not so strong and it cannot really utilize its potential. Because it's a light square bishop, that is the bishop on c8, will always be blocked because of the pawn on d5. So that will be a long-term, it is a long-term drawback. And slowly I can maneuver my knight and try to maybe exploit his weak pawns.
Mm.
And even though the pawns on the b file look doubled, but I have an open file for the rook, which can be useful for the future.
So you mean to say you have this open file,
yeah.
You have even this open file here,
yeah.
And already your rook is on the open file.
Yeah, so my rooks have good, better play than his rooks, and I can maneuver the knight very well to exploit his weaknesses, his weak pawns.
But tell me one thing, black also has this open file here. Does that mean anything or not really?
I can just block it with g3, and I don't really think he has much play on that file. As we'll see in the game, he did not really get any play on the open files, while my knight put a lot of pressure on his pawns.
Yeah. This position is quite a complex one, and that's why the next move is extremely important. Here Swapnil came up with an idea which is very unique. In fact, when I asked Swapnil, so while we are talking, please think of a good move for white.
Yeah.
When I asked Swapnil to find a good game for today's show, I thought you will come up with some, maybe your aggressive game,
yeah.
Some sacrifice, some, or maybe you have beaten some strong players, Aryan Tari or some 2600 GMs, you would show that. But you chose this one, and now I'm beginning to understand that this is really a very interesting game.
Yeah, usually when players are told to show their best games, they will come up with some nice sacrifices, beautiful finishes. But yeah, that is a nice idea. But such games are also quite interesting because we'll get to learn a lot about positional chess.
Yes.
How to maneuver our pieces to the best ways.
Mm.
And yeah, basically it may not look very attractive to our eye, but such maneuverings are an essential part of chess, and we should keep learning such things.
That's what happens in your games.
Yes.
I must say to everyone that Swapnil is now a trainer, so he's already thinking on those lines as to how this session would be more useful to the viewers as a trainer, not as a player.
True, yes.
Okay, so here, if you look at this position, we already have few suggestions.
Yeah.
One of them was by Girish Shah,
mm-hmm.
who says knight h4 with the idea of bishop f5, and this was also suggested by few others. What
yeah.
do you think?
Yeah, actually I thought about this plan during the game as far as I remember. But the point is that when I play knight h4 and then when I play bishop f5, black will of course not take on f5, otherwise my knight on f5 will be like a monster, yeah?
Yeah.
So after bishop f5, he has to play bishop e6, and then my knight and bishop are kind of stuck there.
So let's say bishop e6, now you go bishop f5.
Now he won't take on,
he can just
play on the c5 with rook c8 and then e6 and try to double on the c5.
Yeah.
And my knight and bishop are stuck. So if I take on e6, of course I improve pawn structure, which I don't want to do.
Fantastic. So although this looks very logical, there's no clear improvement
True.
For white.
And my knight is not really doing anything special.
And what about getting your knight here? Does that make any sense or not much? Like bishop e6, knight f5?
Yeah, I think he will just take on f5 and it will be opposite color bishops where it will be difficult to break through his defenses.
Yeah.
So I would like to keep the knight and try to maneuver to such a square where I can put a lot of pressure on his pawns.
Okay. So now Swapnil has given a small hint to all of you that he would like to maneuver the knight to a square where you can put a lot of pressure. One move which has been suggested a lot is rook a5. Did you consider this move?
Yeah, rook a5 can be made by, I think, bishop e6. And again, I don't really see what the rook is doing so great on a5. Black will simply play a6 and just move on the c5.
Yeah.
So I think the rook or the bishop cannot really pressurize black's position. I need to use the knight properly in order to put a lot of pressure.
Okay. So, guys, don't think for just one move, because as you can see, rook a5 does attack a pawn, but your rook would be slightly misplaced. Still, I feel no one has been... Ashmit Gera has found the right move. And also Aniket Kalagra, Gargi DC also. Fantastic.
Anjali Sawalkar,
Poonam Jadhav, Mini N. Well, Kaushik Academy. I think that you gave them the right hint, advice, that you need to put the knight on a good square.
Yeah.
And they all found it out that the good square is
e3. E3,
right. Fantastic. So you go knight e1 to put the knight from c2 to
e3. Right. And the knight on e3 is very stable, supported by the f2 pawn. So it is difficult to move away from there. Even if the rook attacks it, the pawn on f2 is guarding it safely. And also it puts a lot of pressure on the d5 pawn and also controls the key f5 square.
Fantastic. I think one move that does a lot, and I think after this you can say that you are better. Yes, this position.
I think it is slightly better for white. When you, in fact, I want to mention one thing, that when you analyze such positions with engine, they always give as equality. These positions, but practically it becomes difficult for black to hold on to defend such
right.
positions.
So very difficult to defend such positions, and I guess this was a small, we can go through the full game, but it's a long game.
True.
But what I would recommend all the viewers is, as we go through this game, you can start sending in your questions. Swapnil is now ready. I know a lot of you had asked questions before. But we will start taking questions now.
Yeah.
So whatever you have, please write it down.
Yeah.
Okay. So bishop c7, knight c2, bishop b6,
rook f1,
bg4. And here you gave up the d4 pawn.
No,
but
g4 bishop is hanging.
Ah, right now it's hanging, so nothing is,
yeah,
you,
so
you defended everything.
I think bishop a2 is also an interesting move because the bishop is not doing anything much on d3. So I need to maneuver it to f3 to attack the d5 pawn.
Fantastic.
So basically the play is going on the d5 pawn.
Okay. So, well, okay, let us take a few questions.
So, yeah.
Vishal Kamath says, thank you very much, Swapnil. My question is, nowadays so many chess material and books are available to study chess. How do we select which is good for us and improve, and how to study openings?
Yeah, there are a lot of good books, and we can see that every day, every month some nice books will be released. The first thing I would suggest is that it's better to go for authors which are quite famous for their work.
Okay.
And which have trained good students. And also I think studying from books is good, but it's better, I would suggest, to hire a good coach if possible, because interacting live with a coach is completely different than just studying from the books. Yeah,
sure.
Because if you have any doubts, you can ask the coach, or you can interact with the coach. So that is a completely different thing. So I would first thing I would recommend is that if you have a local coach or any online coach whom you can work with, it's good to hire such a coach. And then we can select a lot of books. Of course, we can select a book from it depends on also on what level you are actually right now. So if you, I would suggest Doretsky books for higher level.
Okay.
But there are a lot of good books even at a beginner or the intermediate level.
Mm-hmm.
The books of Jeremy Silverman are already quite famous. I think you have done a video about it as
yes.
well. Yeah. So
Jeremy Silverman is personally my favorite, and I think Reassess Your Chess and Silverman's Endgame Course are two good books.
Right.
And as Swapnil mentions, for higher level Doretsky's
books are good, because I feel his material is quite good. Even Jacob Agard books are quite nice. And I was really helped by his books when I was an IM and I wanted to improve my calculations. I wanted to become a GM. So at that time, his books quite helped me quite a lot.
Jacob Agard's
books.
Okay, so the Grandmaster preparation series.
Right. Calculation especially, it's my favorite. So there are a lot of books according to the level, but we should take care that if you are at a beginner stage, let's say if you are 1000 to 1500 rating, you should not really jump into Doretsky books directly, because you may not benefit much from it right
okay.
now.
Okay. So we had one question by Lakshya Kunal Gola, who said, how can I be a GM without a coach?
Okay.
I understand this question is a very... like you can say he wants to cover a huge distance
yeah.
in just one question, but still, do you feel that it's possible to become a GM without a coach?
I think it is possible, but I feel it will take a lot of time, because if you have a person who is guiding you at each and every phase of your career, it helps a lot. And whatever doubts you have, whatever questions you have, you want suggestions for the openings, you want to learn the ideas of different openings, it's better to have a good coach, good experienced coach.
Mm.
And yeah, it is, I guess, definitely possible to learn from books by playing tournaments and to self-learn everything in chess. But I feel it takes a lot of time. If you take my example, I guess I've worked with a few coaches in my career. Maybe compared to other players of my age, I worked with a lot less coaches. But it took me a lot of time to become a grandmaster. Even though I was passionate, even though I was ready to work hard, I used to
also
work.
Talented. Yes, I can vouch for it.
Okay, so even after working with books, it was still difficult for me to become a grandmaster. It took me a lot of time. So I would from my personal experience, I would say it's best to hire a coach. And if you still, if let's say if there are some financial difficulties for some players, and if they don't have time or something, cannot hire a coach, then of course it's possible. But you need to be a lot passionate, and even the coach in fact motivates you, you know. There are some times when you feel like, okay, chess is, maybe I'm not made for chess, yeah.
Mm.
Maybe the results are not going my way and I don't really want to do chess. Maybe why am I wasting my time here? Sometimes you'll feel like this, but it is the coach who actually supports you in such moments.
Okay. So the coach can actually bring you back on your feet when things are not going your way.
Yeah.
I think you personally went through a lot of financial difficulties. Yes, you were not born with a silver spoon. You had to face a lot of them. I remember that even your father used to travel with you at some point. He gave up his
job
to just make sure, and they were all hoping that you would become a GM.
Yeah.
So how was it, and how difficult was it financially for you?
Yeah, it was quite difficult, but I would say I was a bit lucky because both my parents were working. And okay, at some point my parents decided that maybe one of them would travel with me during tournaments, and let's say one will take care of the expenses of home and one will take care of the expenses of my tournaments.
Mm.
So I'm really grateful for my parents who actually sacrificed a lot of things. They sacrificed not just in terms of finance but also in terms of comfort, everything, traveling to a new city.
Yeah.
And in those days the means of communication were not as great as it is today.
Yes.
So it was I'm really grateful to them, and it was really a great thing, and I'm sure they went through a lot, and even parents today go through a lot of sacrifices to, you know, help their kid achieve success in chess. And yeah, it's a great thing. And yeah, financial difficulties is an issue, but I'm sure that a lot of sponsors will come up, because now even MicroSense, I think you gave a lot of good MicroSense gave a lot of good camps of Kramnik, and they are helping youngsters to come up. Yeah, so yeah, but in the end I feel it will be really great if sponsors would come up and help talented youngsters.
Sure. Okay, so next question. We have lot of questions.
Yeah.
So maybe you have to go. I would love that if you can answer more and more people.
Yeah.
So as Aniket Kalagra asks, as a positional player, what is an ideal opening to play with the black pieces against e4, and what is a good book for that?
Okay, there are a lot of good openings against e4 if you want to have a positional setup. You should not... First of all, Sicilian would not be a great choice, I feel, because there are a lot of dynamic lines and you have to face a strong attack from white side,
yeah.
from the black side of whites. So maybe not Sicilian, but I feel, according to my personal experience, Karokhan is a really nice
Karokhan
opening.
Yeah, Swapnil is a big Karokhan expert. So what is the best way to study that opening?
I think there are a lot of interesting books. When I started learning Karokhan, I studied from the book of Karpo. I think it was a reporter of Karpo from the black pieces. And at that time the theory was not so deep and the variations were quite less. So I managed to, you know, study that book and apply it in my games. But nowadays there are a lot of variations and a lot of theory. So I would say grandmaster reporter of the quality chess.
Yeah,
has a book on Karokhan.
Last Shandov,
yeah. That is also an interesting book, and but I think after that there hasn't been a very great book which I can vouch for, but I think that book was quite good. But in general, I think just by studying the theory, it's not like you will just learn opening and you will start playing and achieving good results. We have to play, we will of course make mistakes at the start, but we have to stick to the opening, and we'll learn a lot of things in the process, and we have to improvise it.
Okay, so basically you can look at a lot of games and you should play a lot of games. Maybe games of Karpo could be good if you look at it.
Yeah.
And perhaps I would recommend, he wouldn't do that, very modest, to look at Swapnil's games. I guess he has played a lot of games and he has a very good feel for this opening.
True. Even I would suggest another solid opening could be Petrov defense, e4, e5, Nf3, Nf6. It is also quite solid. And in fact, I have almost completed the material for the book. Like I'm about to write a book for Petrov.
You are writing a book for Petrov.
Yeah.
When is it coming out?
I think it might come early in the next year, 2020.
Okay, so a solid opening for black. For now is Karokan, but when the book comes out, Petrov. Okay, wonderful. Let's look at the next question. Santosh M says, I'm an extreme beginner at chess. Which book should I study to build up all strengths? I think we did cover this Silman's book.
Yeah. But I think for extreme beginners, it is important to solve a lot of tactical problems and start to gather a lot of tactical patterns. Tactical patterns are one thing, and also some basic end games. So it's very important to study basic end games. If he is an extreme beginner, maybe he should first of all master the mating with a rook, double rook, queen, and for the people who are just started out. So tactical, solving a lot of tactical problems and mating ones, mating twos. So in this way, we'll gather a lot of tactical patterns and mating patterns. So that is very essential at the extreme start. And as you progress slowly, of course, you can study the games of world champions or the classical players of the past. So in that way, we can also learn a lot about strategy, about development, about plan, etc.
Okay. We have Tridev Singh Bagel, who says he likes the video very much. He's from Military Engineers. Thank you, Tridev Singh. Lot of questions on books in general. Yeah. We have Sagar Chess, who says, what are your impressions on the Zurich International book? Have you read it? Zurich 1953.
I have read it, but I would say not in extreme detail. But I'm sure that it has been praised by a lot of authors.
Yes.
In chess fraternities, it has been praised a lot. But nowadays, I feel there are a lot of other good books which try to explain the moves in detail. As far as I have read it, I feel the comments are still not in such a detail. So there are a lot of good books who cover the games of classical players in much detail. They try to explain the thought process and the ideas behind the moves. So I feel there are a lot of good options nowadays.
Okay. Well, we are getting a lot of messages saying that you are asking questions. We are going step by step. So please be patient. Your question will be answered. Meanwhile, I would like to say that Swapnil, we can see that on this video, as everyone is watching, there is a logo of Chessbase India.
Yeah.
And next to it, there is a logo of what is it like?
My online academy, Chess Pathshala.
Chess Pathshala.
Yeah.
It looks like Buddha in between, a god like figure, and then there are all the chess pieces around it.
Yeah, basically, I just wanted to give it an Indian feel, so maybe that's why I came up with this idea.
Well, Chess Pathshala is a very interesting name, and do we take it that now you are a full-time trainer and less of a player? What is it?
Yeah, I think nowadays like I've switched to full-time training, because when I try to balance both playing and coaching, but it's quite difficult because the students need time and they need attention. So in that case, if you just go and play tournaments, maybe it's not justice to them. So I thought maybe I should switch to full-time training, and in this way I can help a lot of players.
Okay. Well, if you guys, anyone would like to look at what Swapnil is doing right now, there is his website down below, which we have given, chesspathshala.in. And you can also write to him if you have it. We would be covering more questions, but in case we are unable to cover all of them, there's the email address there.
Sure. They can, of course, get in touch with me.
People can write to you and you would answer them. Okay. There is one question that we have by Alok Nanda Chaudhary,
okay,
who says, how to control your nerves when you have a winning position?
Yeah, I guess that is quite difficult. But I think it depends on our, first of all, it depends on our nature. If you are getting into this many times, because some players, I have known that even they get a winning position and they convert it effortlessly, smoothly. But there are some players who, get nervous when they are winning. And even they get nervous in time pressure. So basically I would say meditation would be a great solution for them.
Okay.
Because it will help you calm the nerves, not just at home, but let's say if the round is about to start in half an hour, so maybe you can just meditate for 5 to 10 minutes before the round, or you can go to the board, let's say 10 minutes earlier, and try to get into the zone, get into the zone and get into the perfect mindset, so that you can remain cool and calm. You can calm down your nerves. Also,
do you meditate?
Yeah, I meditate, but not regularly, I would say.
Okay.
But whenever I feel that maybe, you know, I'm also getting, let's say, excited or a bit nervous before the game or during time pressure, so I would, in that case, meditate.
Okay.
And yeah, we can also use a lot of breathing exercises. For example, we can use deep breathing, especially when we are in time pressure. Or, if you feel that in positions where we, you know, mess up a lot of times. For some people, it might be winning positions. For some people, it might be, you know, positions where they have to defend. So people may get nervous in different circumstances. So in such situations, you know, self-talk is also a very important thing, which I've used quite a lot.
Okay.
And which I also suggest my students. So, you know, they can talk to themselves and they can motivate themselves. For people who are in winning positions, most of the times they will get a bit excited and they will miss a simple thing by the opponent. Maybe they will just blunder into opponent's ideas, traps. So in such situations, if it is happening regularly, then they should talk to themselves and motivate that, okay, I have got a winning position now. So maybe I should just, you know, focus be careful of opponent's traps and ideas. And prophylaxis is an important tool which they can use in winning positions.
Yeah, well, fantastic. So all those who have trouble winning positions, very good advice by Swapnil there. One of the questions which we are getting from Aryaman Sain,
okay,
is you have stagnated at 2500 level.
Yeah.
What is the reason for that? It's a very personal question and also self-introspective in nature.
True.
Would you like to answer that?
Yeah, sure. I must say it was a really, really tough period for me in my chess career. Okay, I had been stagnated during my final IM norm. It took like 1.5 years to complete my final IMM, but stagnating in 2500, that was a really tough period for me. And the reason, I think, would be a mix of factors. It's not like just one particular reason that because of which I was stagnated, I was not becoming a grandmaster. But there were a lot of reasons. As one of the viewers said, getting nervous. That was also one of the reasons why, you know, I was not able to convert winning positions, or I used to mess up badly in time pressure. So in order to conquer that, I must say I did a lot of meditation at a time, before the game especially. And also I did a lot of physical fitness thing for, let's say, yoga and other physical exercises, which would keep me fit and energetic. And basically it was also about the mindset, you know. When I used to come close to a GM norm and I used to miss it, I used to feel really bad, and then I used to, you know, give up hope that maybe, okay, if I become GM, I become GM, otherwise I won't become GM. So that kind of mindset had entered. But at some point I just decided that, okay, no matter what, I have to become GM. And I was like completely focused on just one thing. And then I made a training program for myself, how do I work.
This is a big question of all the people, how to make a training program. They have time, but they don't know what to do. So
yeah,
maybe you can involve this part of your preparation and give them an idea.
Yeah, basically the first thing is, you know, you have to analyze yourself, what kind of a person you are, what are your strengths and weaknesses, not just in the game, but also in your character. Some people get nervous easily, some people are overconfident. So there are different types of people. So you have to analyze yourself, what kind of character do you have. And also what kind of weakness, because, you know, character reflects a lot in the game, in the chess game. If someone is aggressive in his day-to-day life, maybe he can be aggressive at the board as well. So that character can, of course, come in the chess game. So first of all, it's best to, you know, analyze the character of yours, what are the strengths and weaknesses. Also, you can analyze the strengths and weaknesses of your play. It's best, you know, as I said earlier, to have a coach and, you know, send games to him and, you know, get a good opinion, an experienced opinion about your strengths and weaknesses. And, okay, if you don't have a coach, maybe you can ask a friend to analyze your games, or maybe if you can analyze yourself as well. Once you make a list of your strengths and once you make a list of your weaknesses, then you can select a training program. Again, if you have a coach, it helps a lot. But if you don't have a coach, and maybe then you can select, let's say if you want to improve positional chess. So I would suggest you can study the games of classical positional players like Rubinstein, like Capablanca, like Smyslov, Petrosian. So studying the games of such players, we learn a lot about positional chess.
Okay.
And if you have problems in attacking positions, we can study games of good tacticians, attackers like Tal, Alekhine, and we learn a lot in the process as well. So studying commentated games is a sure way to improve and learn a lot in the areas which you want to improve.
Hmm.
And there are other books as well. Like I had a lot of problems in calculation during my that period where I was stagnated and I was not able to cross 2500.
Hmm.
So at that time I had a lot of problems with calculation. So in such situations, if I just work on opening, it won't really help me to become a grandmaster or to improve my game. So I kept all the opening books, all the opening preparation aside. I kept all the opening books aside, and I just focused on calculation. And so at that time, I think this new book of Jacob Eggard, The Calculation, it was released, and I made it a point. Like I decided that no matter what, I will just focus on this book, and once I start. And until I complete the book, I am not going to keep that book aside, no matter what. So, I used to sit from like 10 p.m. to, let's say, 2 a.m. because that period is, I think, like a golden period for a chess player, because there is no disturbance, no noise, and we can focus very easily.
Mm.
So that
don't give advice now to go to sleep on time and wake up early. 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. That's when he was working on his calculation, because he was very quiet. Yes?
Very quiet, and in those days, even I had to go to the job for half day. So I used to be a bit tired in afternoon and in the morning phase. So I thought that this is the best period for me. Of course, it's not a universal suggestion that you should, if you work from 10 to 2, you will become a grandmaster. But it worked well for me, and everyone has to find their own timing where they can focus properly on their practice.
Okay.
But practicing with full focus is an important thing which we should aim for.
So I would say what Swapnil essentially in a gist is that you need to analyze your games, you need to figure out where you are weak,
yeah,
and then build your time table or the schedule accordingly.
Exactly.
You can't just make a random plan saying, okay, 2 hours of tactics, 3 hours of end games, 2 hours of this study. It will be less effective.
Yeah, I think at the start it might be a good thing to learn a lot of things from different areas. But if you're stagnated for a long time at a certain level, it's best to analyze deeply and make a plan. Like maybe in calculations I'm lacking, so I'll just study and work on calculations.
Mm.
If I'm lacking in simple positional things, so I will study this positional chess. So if you're stagnated at a certain level, then of course you should try to analyze and in detail and try to do that.
So overall, if someone has stagnated, they should have their games and they should go to a trainer, and the trainer will look at the games and then find out. I think this is the most logical way
thing,
to improve.
Yeah, I think an experienced trainer can easily figure out in which areas you are lacking and what mistakes you are repeatedly doing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Okay, we have so many questions that were coming on. Let me pick up one. Lot of questions are coming where people say, I have started chess late.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 20 years old. Or even I read by, who was it? Abhishek Jha, but also someone who said, I'm 42 years old, I've just started playing chess, do you think I can become Datta Kumar? Do you think that if you start chess late, there is a possibility to become a GM?
Yeah, I think there is a possibility, but I would say practically it's extremely difficult, because when already at 42, I think they must be facing a lot of responsibilities, family responsibilities, and also there are health issues. Like according to my personal experience, when I was very young, let's say 15 to 16 years, 18 years, 20 years, I had a lot of energy. I can play double rounds with ease.
Mm.
I used to play rating tournaments where there used to be double rounds. I used to play like 4 to 5 tournaments in succession, and still I did not have any problems with energy. But after 25, 26, I experienced that the energy level goes down for sure.
Okay.
So it's of course, if someone is extremely physically fit, then it's a completely different issue. But an average person's energy usually starts declining after a certain age. It depends on person to person, but the energy level starts declining, and that could be an issue. But of course, if you are extremely passionate at chess, maybe there's a good chance that you will keep on improving, but reaching a grandmaster title is, I would say, practically very difficult.
Very difficult, okay. Maybe it's also, as Swapnil rightly pointed out, a matter of responsibility. You have a lot of things to take care of,
yeah,
and you can't single-mindedly focus on chess.
Chess, right.
Maybe if you can, and if you can do it, why
yes.
not?
Yeah,
I mean,
of course.
It would be wonderful. Okay, let's see a few more questions. I think we had... there are plenty of... there is one question by Lukas Wedirochowski. I think maybe from which country,
Polish.
Lukas, you
Polish,
can...
Yeah.
Poland, yeah. He says, could you please share some insight on how grandmasters structure their databases in programs such as Chessbase? How do you structure your databases?
Basically, there are a lot of ways which we can do it. Some players prefer just opening reporter for white and open report for black, and they will put all the files in those two databases. I would like to, let's say if I am interested in one language which is quite trending, so I will just create a database called normal work or some recent work or something. And in that database, I will start analyzing the recent line which is trending. And once I feel that, okay, this line has some substance which maybe I can use it in my games. So I will then, transfer that line to a proper database. Let's say white side reporter or something, and I will transfer that file to my proper database. But whenever I am analyzing a recent trending line which I am not sure whether I will apply it or not, so unless I am quite sure, only then I will transfer it to my normal database. So we can create different databases for openings. That is also one way to do it. Or we can just put all the openings, all the analysis in just one database, so that it is easy to sort out.
Okay.
So there are different ways to do it, but I personally, try to organize it in one single database so that it's very easy to sort out by control F filter.
I would like to tell all the viewers that when we started Chessbase India back in 2016, our first customer, or you can say the first buyer, was Swapnil. He was the first one who got Chessbase and Mega Database, and of course he uses it for his work and for training and everything. Gargi DC says, whenever I face a higher rated opponent, I lose my confidence. What should I do for that?
First of all, you have to play on the board, yeah? So, maybe just thinking a lot about the outcome, whether we'll win or whether we'll manage to draw or something like that. But one thing is sure that, let's say if you're worrying a lot about the game and your opponent just comes and blunders, so there's no point in worrying, right? You will just win the game on the spot. And such things can happen a lot, or it could be a simply bad day for him. Maybe he was not able to sleep properly, and you are just able to outplay him. Maybe he was not able to focus. So such things can happen, and we never know whether he will be at his peak or not for that game. So it's always good to be hopeful. And at a given day, I have seen a lot of instances in my own personal career where I was able to outplay my higher rated opponents, and where even I got outplayed by much lower rated opponents, even kids sometimes. So it can happen anytime, and since you are worried that you are facing higher rated opponents, the higher rated opponent can also be worried that I am facing a lower rated opponent and maybe I will get outplayed today.
So maybe going to the game with nothing to lose attitude is a good idea.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Also, it works differently for different people, but it's always good to be hopeful, and on a given day you can maybe beat very strong players as well.
Great, fantastic. Kirti Mishra says, I'm going to play Inter-University tomorrow, so can you please wish me luck?
Okay, best of luck, Kirti. I hope you are able to focus and give your best in your games.
Okay, wonderful. Tina Popley says, how many hours per day can we divide for improvement in opening, endgame, and solving some puzzles and playing? I think you already touched upon this on making a schedule, but maybe just a final word on this.
Yeah, I think solving should be done on a daily basis, whether it's tactical positions or it's mating patterns, or solving has to be a part of your daily program on working on chess. Apart from that, I think opening preparation, maybe you can just select opening and work on it continuously. That is one of the ways to do it. But yeah, solving has to be involved in your daily program for sure, because it keeps, you know, it keeps us sharp in solving good position and in our games.
Okay. Well, one question is playing against engine useful? I think this was...
And also I want to touch on playing. Yeah, nowadays there's a lot of online platforms.
Yes, this is two things. Playing online and playing against engine, I think, and also playing against humans.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you suggest?
I would suggest that playing against humans is anytime much better than playing against engines.
Mini N asks, is playing against engines like Fritz, the openings which we have prepared, useful? So maybe this question also fits.
Yeah,
in.
I feel, but the main thing regarding openings, I feel, is that you should be having a general idea about what are the plans, where does my pieces belong in a particular structure, and where does my pieces go. You know, let's say if you finish the opening phase, I have seen many players who have simply no idea about what is going on after that. So it's better not just to, you know, just learn move by move, but it's much important to study the plans once the opening is over. How does the game progresses, and what are the, you know, what I should be doing after this opening phase is over. So it's good to study opening in this way, structure wise, plans wise, and not just move to move. And you know, someone asked the question, as you said, that whether this engine analysis helps a lot. I feel at a lower level it doesn't really help much at all. It's best, you know, if you just study games of good players in your openings, which you regularly play, that should be sufficient, you know, to get a comfortable position out of the opening. And this engine analysis, okay, it has been trending right now quite a lot, but it helps at a much higher level, maybe at a GM level, but surely not at a lower level. Like, it doesn't really help much. So
okay,
you need to focus more on plans and how the pieces are developed after the opening is over. And even you can study the endgames arising out of a particular opening.
Wonderful. we saw one question by, who was it? No Science with Ravish, who says, how to manage time. So I would like to answer on your behalf. Anyone who has time trouble issues can go to Swapnil's website, Chess Pathshala, and there is a big article on it, on which Swapnil has written about time management.
Yeah.
I think you are also writing a few articles trying to tell people about these important subjects.
Yeah, important subjects such as pattern recognition maybe and time pressure. So I am also planning to write a good article on pattern recognition in chess, which is an important aspect of chess improvement. So there are a lot of issue, a lot of aspects of chess improvement like calculation or time pressure or whatever. So I'm planning to write detailed articles on all these issues so that people can get an in-depth idea about how to improve in such things if they are lacking.
Okay, wonderful. So yes, keep going to his website and check out few of the articles. I think they will be very interesting for you.
Yeah, they can also follow our social media handles where we'll be updating the latest articles.
Chess Pathshala on Facebook,
yeah,
Instagram,
Twitter. Right.
Okay.
So we'll be updating, we always daily update positions, like position of the day or something. And also if I write an article, we'll be posting on social platform so that they can connect to it.
Okay. Fantastic. So let's look at one more question here. Too many, it's moving very quickly. Who's asks, what's the main idea in the English opening? Any good lines with white and black, some tricks or something, any traps in the English?
Traps in the English, I guess, is quite difficult because it may not be a dynamic opening. Also depends on how black, you know, approaches your first move c4. If you replace c5, maybe it will lack a lot of traps. But I would suggest the Marine's book again of quality chess.
Uh-huh.
Because I have seen a lot of players who have learnt English have taken use, have made use of that book, the two volumes of Marine, the English opening.
Yeah.
And yeah, nowadays they can also get a lot of videos, a lot of other books on English opening. But I feel the Marine's book is quite good.
Okay. Okay. We had Omkar Brahma Bhatt, who was very keen that you answer one of his questions, and he said it will make his day.
Okay.
He says, how to analyze your own games?
Yeah, I think this is an important question because, as I said before, if you are kind of stagnant at a level, the best thing is to analyze yourself, your own games. So I think most people, what they do is that if they lose a game or if they win a game, they will just come back to the hotel room and they will just say, okay, maybe this is where I made a mistake. They will switch on the engine out of habit. And the engine will show them, okay, this is the particular mistake that you did.
Nowadays, you don't even have to come back to the room. You have a mobile phone.
Yeah.
And true. You can just see
as
it.
As soon as
that.
You come out of the tournament, all you will just check where I made a mistake.
Yeah.
But it doesn't, I think just satisfies your curiosity. It doesn't really help you become a better player. The best way is to come back after the tournament and check about the patterns of mistake you are doing. Maybe some people, they don't really handle the endgame well. Their score in the endgame is quite bad. Once the queens are exchanged, maybe they are just getting outplayed by the opponent.
Mm.
Or some people, if the position becomes dynamic, they simply have no clue of what is exactly happening in the position. So the best thing is that to come back from the tournament and analyze such patterns of mistakes which they are making repeatedly. Only then we can, you know, build up a plan on that, on how to improve.
Yeah, yeah.
So patterns of mistakes is much more important than an individual move, which the engine shows.
Fantastic. Okay, let's look at some chess, because one question by Poonam Jadhav is, can you tell us a good reply to the London system? I think everyone has this thing, either teach us the London system or show us a good reply to London system. Maybe it's very popular at
basically level. For white players, it's kind of just no headache opening, yeah? You just play d4, bishop f4, e3, c3, knight d2, knight f3. And if black is not aware of the ideas and the plans, maybe white can get a really strong attack on the king side. So that is
so can you tell a good plan, or would you like to reveal, maybe it can make the London players a little bit sad, but
I think I can just suggest a line quickly.
Okay,
there are a lot of ways which you can actually handle London system, but one of the lines is d4 d5.
Mm-hmm.
They will first develop the, I think it's better to show from the black side, yeah?
Yeah, let's
for the black players.
Okay.
So bishop f4, now knight f6, e3. This is what they play nowadays, c5.
Okay.
Now maybe knight f3.
Yeah, knight f3 or c3.
Yeah. Now we can, I can just show an interesting line which they can follow without much preparation. Here we can play e6.
Okay.
Now maybe knight bd2. Now, it is important not to develop the knight to c6 immediately. Mm,
okay.
So, we can just play bishop d6 first. Now, usually they will tackle bishop d6 with bishop g3.
Yeah.
And now, we can play either first castle or either first queen c7.
Okay, so what do you recommend?
Maybe we can go with queen castles first, no problem. I think it will transpose to more or less same thing.
Okay, c3 maybe?
Now, queen c7. So again, we are delaying the development of the knight to c6. The point is that we want to develop our knight to d7.
Ah, fascinating. Okay.
Yeah, and then we want to take the e5 break. So basically, the main strategy of white players in this line is that they want to, you know, put a knight on e5 and then play f4 and then start rolling their kingside pawns.
Mm.
So our idea is to, you know, prevent it with queen c7, knight bd7. That is, now we can see the difference why we don't really want to first play knight c6 and queen c7. We can just show our viewers that. So maybe, now if we, after c3, if you play knight c6, and then white plays the usual bishop d3. Now if we play queen c7 here, then white can take on dc5.
And you cannot take bishop c5 because your queen is hanging.
Yeah.
And you will just be a pawn down.
Yeah, and then he will protect his pawn with b4, and it won't be so great. Also, we are forced to exchange on g3 when his h5 will be open.
Correct.
He can create attacking chances there.
So, in this case, when you go queen c7, and now if he takes, you can take with the queen simply.
Yeah, we can simply take back with the queen, and this is a fine position for black. So, the main point is what happens after bishop d3. After queen c7, bishop d3.
Yeah, bishop d3, which is the main move.
Yeah, now we just stop his knight d5 ideas forever by playing knight bd7. And let's say if he castles here, then we can just take on g3 now, since the rook has already moved from the h-file, hg3, and now we can break with e5 immediately. So I think this is a very comfortable position for black already.
Well, I'm impressed. I'm going to play this if my opponents play London. I have only one question here. If instead of playing bishop d3, if white played knight e5, is this a possibility?
Yeah, knight e5 is a possibility for sure. Then I think it is best to go for b6, as far as I remember.
b6?
Yeah. f4, or let's say bishop d3, whatever, bishop b7, and again we'll, yeah, castles, now knight bd7, f4. Now it is very, very important to remember that we should not allow white to play queen f3 and stop our knight e4 idea. So whenever white plays f4, we should be ready to jump on the e4 square with knight e4.
Okay.
So this is an important thing. And then we can kick his knight with f6, which white cannot do with f3. And once we kick his knight, there is of course no attack because we have blocked his diagonal, the b1 h7 diagonal. So this is the important point to remember, that whenever white plays f4, we need to jump with knight e4. We need to be ready for that.
Swapnil, I am impressed. You have been able to give a repertoire for black in less than 3 minutes.
Yeah.
I can see that a lot of people are now asking for different recommendations to different openings. But okay, for today, I think the London system, you have a good weapon with black. And I'm sure that white players can find some kind of holes in this analysis. Maybe they can also try to figure out
something. Of course. I mean, if you go deep into the theory, there are a lot of things which you can try from either color. But I feel that these ideas, you know, they can just go and play. And I feel this is a very safe option against the London system.
Yeah. And the nice thing is that when we were showing this, the flow of questions reduced. People were looking at the analysis.
Yeah.
Okay, so there is one interesting question by Yagna Rama. He says, please give a timetable for office goers.
Okay, I was also office goer when, you know, when I was stagnated, though. I was used to go only for 4 hours to the office.
You used to go to the railways and you were working in railways.
Yeah,
so you
still,
are still.
I'm still working in railways, but nowadays they have given us full day off. So we can practice and play, work for the railway tournaments and all. But in those days, I used to go half day. So that's why I said that for office goers or for people who are kind of busy the whole day, the best time is from 10 to 2.
10 to 2. So, question.
I mean, if they're really serious and passionate about it.
Yagna Raman, Santosh, please make sure that 10 p.m. to 2 a.m. you are conscious.
Yeah, just have dinner and relax for some time. And then just prepare as much as you can.
Well, take my word, you really need willpower to do this because you will feel sleepy. But he, of course, he wanted to become a GM and he worked on it. Okay. Okay, we have some questions. Sujay Bhattacharya says, my daughter is 10 years old. How to improve? I think this is a very general question, but for 10-year-old players,
extremely essential to have a coach.
What? How do you determine a good coach? Because, you know, there are so many trainers these days who are teaching. How do you determine if you have found a good coach or not?
I think in such cases, I feel it's best to, you know, check the coach's past record. If he has trained a lot of students, or if he has trained managed to train some good students who have reached a good level, it's essential to check the past records. I feel that will help a lot,
you know,
in deciding a coach. And one thing I would say is that title doesn't really, you know, let's say if the coach has an IM or GM title, it doesn't really say that he's a good coach.
Mm.
He's a good player, of course, but being a good coach is like a completely different thing. The main ingredient, I think, is that the coach should actually care for the student, for the student's result, and he should always keep the student's preferences and time and results and work much above than his own games and tournaments.
I think this is a very genuine suggestion by Swapnil, because, you know, he could have easily said, him being a GM, that a title player is a good coach, but no,
of course not. Someone who actually cares for your child's results is, I feel, a much suitable coach for your child than a person who is holding a GM or an IM title for
okay.
any time.
Mangesh 619 says, should puzzles be solved on a board or computer screen?
I would suggest, if the puzzles are very easy, then you can just finish it off in the computer screen. But if you feel that the puzzle is a bit challenging, the position are a bit challenging, and you are not able to solve it quickly, then it's better to solve, just put the position on the board and try to figure out the solution.
Okay.
And I would anytime prefer to solve on the board.
You like it. Okay. Suther Shun Asokan says, I'm working on chess for 12 to 14 hours. Is it a bit too much?
I feel it's quite a lot. Also, you know, the number of hours doesn't really matter so much. What matters is what is the quality of your work. are you able to completely focus for 12 to 14 hours, which I feel is not such an easy task for sure. But if you are able to manage just to, you know, take four hours out of your day and completely focus in those 4 hours on your training, that would really go a long way. I mean, that will help a lot. So the quality of your training matters a lot. The quality of the material from which you are actually training, that also matters a lot. So these two things, I think anyone who is working continuously on chess should take care of.
Yeah, this is also, I think one of the traps in which I used to feel. I feel that if you work hard, you will improve. Yeah, it's true, you have to work hard, but quality is also important.
Quality is extremely important. And nowadays, you can see that there are so many distractions, the social media, mobile and all. So that's why I kind of make it a rule, you know. Especially when I was working at 10 p.m. to 2 a.m., I made a rule that I will switch off my mobile and work. Mm. And even nowadays, whenever my students come, I kind of switch off my mobile, keep the mobile aside and try to, you know, train them.
Okay. I have one question. There are so many questions here, but I would like to ask, and I think this is a question which many people have. You are now getting married. Yes, you will be getting married in what? A week from now,
yeah.
7 days,
yeah.
On 11th of December.
Yeah.
And you will be marrying a chess player,
yeah,
as well. Sonakshi
Rathod.
So the question to you is, does, you know, you said about distractions and everything, so you had a girlfriend in chess. Does it help in chess? Does it distract you? What's your take on this? Many people have this question.
I think it's a very subjective thing, because it also depends on the person whom you are kind of, you know, in relationship with. So if the person is quite understanding, even if she is not a chess, he or she is not a chess player, but if he or she understands you quite well, then of course I feel life becomes quite easy. Sometimes it may happen that, you know, the relationship has just started and maybe you guys don't know each other well, but after a certain point you start knowing each other well, and you kind of, you know, adjust to the needs and priorities of your partner. So if it goes well and if the other person is able to understand you, I think it can surely help in your career, because many times it happened that I was quite low on confidence. Especially in that stagnation period where I was, you know, not able to cross 2500, but she always kept supporting me, and she always kept motivating me. I still remember that my rise, you know, from 2460 or 2470 to 2500 started when I won that National Challengers tournament in Nagpur, and it was there that we met after a long time. I met Sonakshi after a long time, and she kind of motivated me. So I feel that helped quite a lot.
Well, Swapnil, multi-talented personality, can speak on variety of subjects, and this is definitely something, a big moment in his life. He will be getting married soon. So a lot of things changing for you. You are now a full-time trainer. You're also going to be a husband soon. You were also the coach of the Indian women's team,
yeah.
The national women's team,
yeah,
at World Team Championship.
At the World Team Championship, yeah, mainly for that. And also I was the second of the Indian women's team for the Olympiad.
So in that team we had Hampi, Harika, Padmini, Tanya, and Isha. And so all the top women players, and how was your experience?
Yeah, it was quite interesting. I mean, I was the second for the first time. And it was quite interesting, you know, there are a lot of things to learn from the Indian women's team, their dedication, their passion, their passion, you know, to improve. And especially from Ambi, who was, you know, whenever she used to practice, the one thing I noticed in her is that whenever she used to practice, she used to be like completely laser sharp focus on the practice. And I can, you know, I recall one funny incident as well, like during the camp, I was playing blitz game with Isha. And I used to, you know, just always like usual crack jokes, you know, try to kind of distract the opponent and win the game in some trick. So I was doing the same thing, but Hampi, you know, she said that Swapnil, you should not talk during the blitz game. So it kind of shows, you know, whenever she trains, she always like to train with complete focus and sincerity. So I always picked that from her. And the whole Indian women team, you know, they are so much motivated to do well.
Mm.
No matter what kind of difficulties they faced or at what level they are stagnated, but they are always, you know, motivated to do well. So it kind of even inspires me to do my best in training.
Okay. Partha Pratim Nath says, can you recommend two books on improving planning, strategy and calculation?
Calculation, as I said, okay, depends on what level he is right now, but Jacob Agard's calculation is quite good if he has already, let's say, around 2000 rating or something. For calculations, I would say there are a lot of other books, maybe the Power Play series of Daniel King, that is also a good start, but also there are other calculation books. But I would say at a lower level, it's much more important to study the games of classical players. I have repeated it many times because I feel that's really, really important, you know.
How do you study games of classical players?
I feel it's best to, you know, find the games of classical players which are commented in a proper way. For example, if you want to study the books of the games of Karpo, there's also, I think, recently released series of Karpo by Tibor Caroli for quality chess. And also you can find a lot of books which, you know, have commented games of such great players. So it's always important to, you know, study games of such from such books which have, you know, tried to explain the ideas behind the moves of the great players rather than just going through the game.
Okay. Whose has said, for how long have you been playing chess and from what age did you start playing?
I've started, I feel, comparatively late. I started when I was around 10 years of age, and it's almost like some 19 years. 19 years I've been playing chess, I've been connected to chess in some way or the other.
Okay. Geeta Devi, you are asking about time pressure. I think Swapnil has written a very good article on his website on time pressure. So please do visit his website and have a look. Is My Great Predecessors a good book for classics?
I think Mini it's a good book, but I feel that the book is, you know, it's written with a lot of variations inside the game, so that could be frustrating for young players, especially for young kids. That's why I feel that showing the games which has more comments and less variations is a better approach, you know, to train the kids or to train lower levels of players, where they can learn a lot from the game rather than, you know, just going through the variation, going through the computerish variations. It's better to, you know, study games which has a lot of more comments than variations.
Okay. Well, Swapnil, you know, there are so many more questions, and I see your approach is that any question we give to him, he takes his time, he gives a structured answer. So definitely it's not possible. It was not like a rapid fire where we could take each question and he would give an answer in 10 seconds or 15 seconds.
No, I would love to, but I think we have time constraint.
Yeah, definitely. And I think it make when you answer one question, you are actually... answering many more questions of other people. And yes, we couldn't give a shout out to everyone, but I think there were a few questions like Pinaki Purkayasta, who said what to eat in the games. I think this is an important thing. What were you eating in your games? During tournaments?
Yeah, actually when I was very young, I didn't really and I was not dependent on this energy products like maybe chocolates or something. But I always used to carry a water bottle with me. That's the only thing I carried when I was quite young. But after a certain period of time, when I played tournaments like Isle of Man, which had three time control, so it was a really long game. Maybe 5.5 hours, at some point sometimes it even went to 6 hours. So at a time, during such long games, I would of course suggest to have a chocolate, anything sweet which can energize your body once again, energize your mind. And also, it's not just about eating, but also you can relax a bit through a lot of breathing exercises. So that is also something which ambitious chess players can learn. And I use it, let's say after 4 hours of chess, you kind of get tired, so you can just relax a bit using some breathing exercises. And it's always good to keep chocolates with you.
Okay.
But having too much food can also be distracting, so you have to maintain a balance with that.
Right. Okay, so guys, I think we've almost covered 1 hour of Ask Swapnil. He showed you a game of his. We looked at, we answered a lot of questions. He gave you an antidote against London system. I would also like to mention that Swapnil has his own academy, Chess Pathshala, the logo of which you can see on the video, and also there is the website where you can visit, and there is an email. So, Swapnil, what do you think? Like, let's say we, the approach is whenever someone wants to improve, they should look at the games and try to find weaknesses, which I think a coach can do a good job.
Much better,
so
yeah.
So imagine if people send you their games, which you analyze and try to find this. Is it a possibility? Can people send you their games? How does it work?
Yeah, I think they can send me their games for sure. And I'll whatever time I have, I will try to do that. Or even I have just hired coaches. I'm actually going to hire coaches for my academy. And also kind of train them with my training methods. And how to spot weaknesses in the players' games. How to exactly train players. So I'm going to train them with my training methods, which I've developed since a few years back, and I feel that will help quite a lot. So I can my coaches can also the coaches working in the academy can also analyze the games and help players to improve and to make a proper plan.
Okay.
And also we are about to start courses in our academy. It could be something like tactics course, positional course, endgame course. So if a certain player, if they send games to chesspatchal@gmail.com and we analyze the games and we figure out that, okay, this is the area which they should work on if they are kind of stagnated, or this is the area which they are lacking in. For example, if someone is lacking in the endgame, so they can, of course, take our endgame course it's not like a group class, but a coach will be assigned to the student who can work on an individual level or personal level with the student. So
okay.
I feel that is a much better technique, a much better way of studying than a group class.
Okay. In any case, I would recommend anyone who would like to interact with Swapnil, write to him on his email address, chesspathshala@gmail.com. I think there is an additional A in after SHA.
Yeah, yeah.
So please take care and write to him. He would respond to you. And I would just give a shout out to all the people who are recently writing. Maybe we couldn't answer your questions, but a lot of questions came. Datta Kumar, who was very active, Arman Siddiqui, Omkar Brahmabhat, Pradeep Kanitkar, Purav Kadiyan. Thank you all. I think many more names I could say, but all of you were here. You listened to this. I hope you enjoyed it. Swapnil,
I hope so too.
Thank you for visiting the Chess Base India office.
I think thank you for conducting this show. I think a lot of people would have benefited with the advices and the tips.
Yeah,
hopefully at least the London system.
I'm sure if nothing else, they would London system might reduce in popularity perhaps. But we hope to do this again with Swapnil whenever
sure.
he comes to Mumbai. He lives in Amravati, which is close to Nagpur in Maharashtra. And whenever he comes here, we hope to do this again. Once again,
yeah.
Thank you all. And
thank you so much.
Hope to see you soon.